and we're back. I was not expecting this of the two movies tonight to be the one that we're stuck in the front row for.
Right, right.
So I got the tickets earlier.
Just like this, the whole night. Dude. Just like looking over at Ailes, over at Megyn Kelly, back at Ailes.
Yeah, yeah. Like, so I got, when I got the tickets earlier, like, granted, it was in a small theater in there.
Yeah.
It was, like, jam-packed in there. Like, the only seats that were available were just the ones in the front row.
Yeah.
And then I was expecting that to be the case with Spies in Disguise.
Right.
When I clicked on Spies in Disguise, we were the first ones to get tickets. Like, weird. I wasn't expecting. I like how sometimes with the Regal app, when you get, it reminds me of, like, when you get more points for seeing something versus another movie. So let's say, like, you go see Frozen 2 or something like that, or Star Wars, and you'll get like 1500 points or rewards or whatever. Meanwhile, we go see like Warrior Queen of Jhansi, is like, here's 50 points.
I never knew that. I never
watched that. It's actually kind of funny.
I never noticed that. That is funny. So you get less points for the more obscure stuff, or
I think it's kind of random because I've seen it vice versa before.
Oh, okay.
But
that's interesting.
It's always kind of funny when that's the case. Like, here's 2,000 points. You went to go see Cats. Anyway, here's 50 bucks. You went to go see... 50 bucks. Here's 50 points. You went to go see Great Alaskan Race. Thanks. Just try not to spend it all in one place. And this has been out a week. We were planning on seeing it last weekend, but we had to catch a really early morning flight. Laura... We were planning on doing a double and seeing...
Oh, he's going to blame his wife.
No. Like, no, I mean, granted, it was 100% her fault. No. We were going to see Cats and Bombshell, but she was already not feeling very good, and we did have to get up early to catch a flight. So I was like, it's not... I was like, it's... Cats, we definitely gotta, like, gotta try to squeeze in Cats before we leave. I was like, Bombshell, there's not really a time limit on a review for this. I'm like, it's fine if we see it during the week. And so, and she was like, she was also like, okay, yeah, like, I wouldn't mind seeing Bombshell later. She goes, but I don't care. She's like, I don't care how much, like... I don't. She's like, I don't care if I'm missing a leg. I am seeing Cats tonight. We just had to know, man.
Dang.
We just had to know. But there's got to be. So this is one that's like, you could probably put this in the genre of, or the category of movies like The Big Short or Vice that came out last year, where it's very topical political stuff, but done not so much as like a straight out comedy, but with certainly a sense of humor to a lot of stuff that's going on, with a lot of like explaining things to the camera.
Yeah.
Making like kind of clever
a lot of fourth wall.
Yeah. And I'm watching going like, okay, this is almost kind of a subgenre in and of itself right now, where I don't know what you would call it. Like,
had a very Office vibe.
Sure, yeah. Like, snarky drama, I guess you could kind of call something like this.
Snarky drama.
Huh?
Snarky drama.
Snarky drama.
Hashtag.
Snarky drama.
Hashtag snarky drama.
The Big Short, Vice, and now Bombshell. Bombshell is the one... Man, it was like... So being in the front row for a movie like this, I'm like, that's as close as I want to get to seeing like Roger Ailes on a big screen, like stuck in the front row for some of these scenes with John Lithgow.
I was gonna say John Lithgow as
He's
Roger
great
Ailes.
In
he is fantastic. Oh my god,
there is great casting in the
oh
movie.
Man,
like, and it, same with like Vice with Christian Bale doing Dick Cheney in Vice last year. In this, there are some that are so dead on that it's uncanny. Like,
A couple.
There's a few where it's kind of like,
yeah,
but there's
okay.
some, like, Charlize Theron as Megyn Kelly, for instance.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, that was like Christian Bale, where I'm like, right. I feel like I'm watching Megyn Kelly star as herself in a movie.
I saw that. I felt the same way.
Yeah.
But then you saw Hannity, and I'm like, well, that's not really Hannity.
Yeah, I know. There was, but then the
or Giuliani.
Oh, and it was Richard Kind playing Giuliani. Yeah. Then there was like that. But then like the Bill O'Reilly was spot on.
Yeah.
Like that. And Jeannie Pirro. I'd say
pretty good.
The one I forget her name. The brunette. I think she's on The Five. I think she's dating Don Jr. I forget her name, but they have someone playing her, and that was a pretty dead ringer. And Nicole Kidman as Gretchen Carlson was made up to look
pretty freaking accurate. No, I'll agree with that. Yeah.
So, and this is a movie about the scandal at Fox News between all the allegations against Roger Ailes and people coming forward about years worth of shit that Roger Ailes did, but also like it was also a fascinating look behind the scenes as well.
Yeah,
about how
the building is laid out. They actually like said like Roger Ailes is the second floor.
Yeah, the inner office politics not politics, more so just kind of the office politics of the building.
Yeah,
like it presents the issue being a legal issue.
Sure.
Versus the office politics of the situation between
right.
Roger Ailes and different people saying, like, okay.
Team Roger.
Yeah, and Kate McKinnon has a scene where she's like, I don't think you should tell me this right now because they know that we're friends. And, like, different,
Kate McKinnon,
different struggles that characters have just for the sake of kind of keeping their job.
Yeah.
It wasn't just strictly a two-dimensional look at the situation. Even in how Ailes himself is in the movie. Like, he's a monster, yeah, sure. And freaking looks like one.
Right.
But the movie's not lazy in how it writes him.
Right, right.
It's not that they're writing him as just some creature that's coming out of the garbage to just harass a bunch of people. There's some disturbing scenes in this movie. There are.
I agree. I was going to say John Lithgow was also having the time of his life.
Oh, he was. Yeah. A lot of the actors were. But the movie is smart enough to write him in a way, too, that makes it believable how he's in the position that he's in, yeah. And how even people kind of look the other way on certain things, and even how some of these people grew to maybe not necessarily like him, but at least work with him.
Tolerate him.
So the movie was good in that aspect. And what I like, so there's one thing about the movie where, like, okay, it's about all of these allegations against Roger Ailes and Fox.
Mm-hmm.
And there is the one part where it's like, all right, to make a movie like this with the message that they have in this movie, I mean, they did pick an easy target with Fox News. Like, because there is the thing where it's like, I don't know how much Hollywood needs to be pointing fingers, really, in some areas.
True. I will say, if you see like clips of Fox and Friends and how they, you know, even after Gretchen, even after Gretchen's time on Fox and Friends, they still manage to like poke some. They make a lot of really sexist remarks
show. Yeah, absolutely.
And it's like, wow. And
absolutely.
And their female co-hosts are just floored by how, like, the audacity.
Totally. Like, yo, oh, yeah. And that's, so on the one end of it, it's sort of like, all right, well, really did kind of pick an easy target to make a movie like this. Like, you're gonna, it's going to be easier to pitch a movie like this to a studio.
Sure, yeah.
Than it is to maybe pitch the Harvey Weinstein story, you know what I mean?
Okay, but, okay, we're going to make a movie about Harvey Weinstein's sexual harassment. Whoa.
I mean, it might happen, but like, so, but on the one end of that, like, what I like about the fact that it is about Fox and people like Gretchen Carlson, Megyn Kelly, all these people, is that, I mean, you were... It really puts a human face on a lot of that in that, like, it's easy. It's, you can absolutely criticize things Megyn Kelly said in the past. Same with Gretchen Carlson.
Oh, sure.
Same with a lot of these people. You can. But this movie does show you that, like, you can disagree with somebody what they say on the news. At the end of the day, that's still a fucked up thing that happened to them. And they still are a person. They are a human being behind this person you see on the news. Like, it is scary to see things that Megyn Kelly was sent in the mail, what they were doing to her family, what they were saying outside these conventions and everything. Like, so I do, in that aspect, I'm like, you know what? I like that it is about a lot of these people.
You know what really changed my opinion about Megyn Kelly was, remember when you and I watched the re-election coverage on Obama's re-election coverage on Fox News?
Vaguely.
She turned to Karl Rove as he was like sweating bullets, trying to work the numbers, like, why is Mitt Romney losing? And she goes, is this math that you do as a Republican man to make yourself feel better? I was like, no, she didn't. I was like, this girl is like, I mean, it was at that moment I knew Megyn Kelly had enough of Fox News's shit.
Sure.
And from then, that's whenever the allegations came out. That's whenever she left. That's whenever she went to MSNBC.
She is smart. Like, I mean, you know, even in this movie, like, she's trying to break a lot of things down legally because she is a lawyer.
Yeah.
Like, and that stuff was good to see in the film.
Having said that, though, I felt that this film did an awful lot of, like, painting her as the hero in this movie.
Mm.
And I was just kind of like, was this produced by Megyn Kelly or
what? It is produced by Charlize Theron.
Oh.
But I mean, I did kind of like that it started out sort of, well, I guess the whole thing's kind of an ensemble because it's about her story, Gretchen Carlson's, and Margot Robbie's character. I liked how, at first, it's kind of these three separate things going on. Mm-hmm. It's Gretchen Carlson about to be fired. It's Megyn Kelly's stuff with Trump.
Yeah.
And then, I don't know if this is a real person Margot Robbie's playing or just kind of a hybrid of different people.
I didn't really recognize.
She's kind of this Tommy Loren type.
Yeah.
Who's like young and wants to be like a conservative voice for millennials.
Yeah.
But I
don't remember. Out of all the names that they showed in this movie, hers was the one I just couldn't really.
Yeah, place. That I don't really know. Like, it wouldn't surprise me if it was just maybe kind of a
made up.
Or just maybe a hybrid of some different people. I don't know. But, like, I liked how it starts out about these three kind of separate stories going on and then eventually does intersect in that scene you see in the teaser trailer where they're all in the elevator together.
Oh, yeah.
Then it kind of becomes a larger part of the same story. I guess, if you were to say there is, like, kind of a main one of the three, it would be Megyn Kelly.
Yeah.
They're all kind of given a lot of really good screen time, but, like...
Sure.
And it doesn't... It also didn't shy away, really, from...
But, I mean, there were scenes where, like, Megyn Kelly presented this, like, heroic speech about how, like... no matter what, how much work a woman does in this field, blah, 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 this, that, the other, mm-hmm. and I'm going to try and stop it. I did. I just felt like, you know, Megyn Kelly was like, about to put on a cape and just go, Megyn Kelly away.
I mean, I did like that it showed why she would also be kind of a controversial figure with, like, that clip where she's talking about Santa Claus and things like that.
Right.
Like,
right.
But this did, I thought, in this movie's message, and even when it's doing something like you just said, I thought it was more organic to what was going on in this movie and written well enough, certainly acted well enough, versus what, like, that recent Black Christmas movie did, which was just a really badly written syllabus that someone wrote in 5 minutes. Like,
I'll have to take your word for it.
Oh, God.
But I did enjoy this movie, and I definitely enjoyed the ride that it took me on.
Yeah, I liked it for the performances. I thought it was edited well, too. Yeah. I liked Vice better, and I liked The Big Short better. This, like, I was fine with seeing this movie in theaters. I was. Like, it did at times kind of feel like this probably could have been, like, an HBO movie.
Yes.
But I didn't mind going out to see this.
Yeah.
Like, I thought it was really entertaining.
Yeah.
I did. And it was, honestly, I thought a lot of it was worth it just for a lot of the performances alone.
What would you say is the demographic for this movie? Would it be a conservative crowd? Or
No, because I can't. I mean, I wish that would be the case, but like,
it wouldn't be your typical Fox News viewer, obviously.
Because it's like, the frustrating thing about that is that, like, you can be a fan or a viewer of Fox News, fine, and still admit that what happened to some of these people is screwed up.
Right.
And I could see, especially because it's a mainstream film, I could see Fox viewers maybe staying away from this as if it's going to be just a giant hit piece on Fox. And I don't know. I thought the movie broke it down in realistic terms.
I agree.
With the kinds of stories that they go for, and they paint it like a business, certainly. And when Rupert Murdoch shows up in the movie, who's brilliantly cast by Malcolm McDowell, he's not this just kind of two-dimensional villain. Really, nobody is.
That's true.
They come across like businessmen.
I mean, I was gonna say they did do a good job of giving Rupert Murdoch this honestly, a voice of reason, a voice of, like, a logic, and just, like, he showed up, he was like, Roger, you know, you're my best friend, and all this other stuff, but you know,
it's over.
Yeah, you know, here's your severance pay. It's a lot of money. Come on, Roger, just take the money.
So I think that this movie is, I think it's mostly liberals who are probably going to go see this movie. Same with Vice. Same with, because I've got members of my family who are conservative Republican. And I remember last year, and it's fine. Like, because I remember last year when I saw Vice, a couple of them saying, like, they didn't have any interest in seeing it. And I should say, like, I thought it was pretty fair.
I knew right off the bat that Vice was just more for a liberal audience. I was just wondering, like, would this, do you think some conservatives would go to this, or do you think they'd just be like, nah, this is just too much liberal
propaganda? I think that there's a lot that'll stay away from it because that it's thinking that it's less about
Sexual harassment
and more just kind of like taking a swing at Fox News, which fair, but having seen the movie, do they go after Fox? Because maybe that's an easy target to take a hit at. You know what, maybe, but reviewing it as a movie in terms of its acting, its script, and everything, It's good.
Agreed.
And I thought that it's like I said a few minutes ago, like, you can be a fan of this network or whatever, mm-hmm. and still have empathy for what this movie's about and, right. and who it's about. Because I right. think that's very much the larger story here.
Agreed.
I mean, they even show in the movie someone... this movie isn't calling Fox... There's no point in the movie where someone's calling... Where the movie is trying to paint Fox's Nazi propaganda, basically. Like, it doesn't... It's yeah, not. It's no. not like it's doing that. In fact, if anything, in one scene, it shows someone accost Gretchen Carlson in the middle of a grocery store where she's just kind of minding her own business.
Yeah.
And the lady kind of lays into her. So, that's honestly...
That's true.
The movie does kind of... Show different sides of issues.
I was going to say, if anything, that would be a scene for the conservatives, you know, to see like a liberal woman in a Whole Foods just chastise Gretchen Carlson.
I did kind of like that part where the girl was eating sushi and said to Connie Britton, like, this isn't a liberal food, is it?
No. She was like, this isn't a liberal food. It's a grocery store. It's grocery store sushi. So it's not liberal food. And she's like, whatever.
So I enjoyed it. I liked it. I thought it was edited. It's not going to make my year's best by any means. Yeah. But like, I thought it was an entertaining flick.
Agreed. Yeah.
Would you recommend it theatrically or?
Oh yeah. Yeah, sure. Go see it just before going to see
Spies in Disguise like we did. Yeah. Don't sit in the front row because Roger Ailes will look haunting.
Roger Ailes might touch you. Did this get a 3D showing? Could you imagine Roger Ailes in 3D?
I wish this movie was in 3D.
Right. Roger Ailes just comes at you.
Why did I pay extra money for this? Alright, well, I got some catching up to do on some other stuff throughout the week. We're going to see Uncut Gems and Little Women, and you want to go to that Mall the Merrier movie or whatever
sure.
that was? I'm down.
Yeah.
It's playing at one of the other theaters.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The Mall the Merrier, the I Mall think is what Merrier. It was called. Yeah. Some movie. It's like the kids are competing on who gets ownership of a shopping mall.
I'm like, how does that even work?
The movie's from the Philippines. Maybe they just do mall ownership differently over there. Well, then we'll try to see that, but it's starting to come down a little bit. But yeah.
Before we go, am I going to get to see Uncut Gems or
Laura called dibs on Uncut Gems and Little Women.
Damn it!
I don't know what next weekend is. It's January, so it's probably nothing good.
Right. Damn it.
All right, everyone. Take care.